Welcome to the Bauer Power Hour, where we pack motorsports, power sports, and the outdoor lifestyle with technology, innovation, news, and good times into an action-packed dirt-flinging show. Hosted by the one and only Charlene Bauer, who's been serving the off-road industry for over 20 years. Time to throw the green flag and get ready for another wild lineup.
Hello, fellow off-roaders, and welcome to the first episode of Bauer Power Hour, presented by our great friends at BFGoodrich Tires, Discount Tires, and Kicker Audio. BFGoodrich Tires is having so much fun releasing the KO2 tire and also Comp All Season Street tire with the Are You Driver Enough Tour. Yes, it's been fun, and you've seen me out and about on it. Discount Tire, did you know that they have 900 locations? I have visited a couple of them, but I think we should put that on our bucket list. Let's go visit all 900 locations of Discount Tire. Okay, maybe a little crazy, but it could be fun. And Kicker Audio, well, we got the tires underneath us and we're rolling down the road, but Kicker Audio is keeping us happy inside. What do they say? Fueled for living loud, because that's the way we like to do it. We have an awesome A-plus lineup of guests today. Jason Shear, Ultra 4 racer, Corry Weller, Lucas Oil and SR1 racer, Jeff Knoll from RallyVenture. We have Greg Mulkey from Raceline Wheels, Del Albright from BlueRibbon Coalition, and then we have Matt, 30-pack Matt, who's coming in talking about tech and tools, and then I'll add in a little bit of the Bauer Media adventures. So what is Bauer Power Hour? That seems to be the big question. It's new, it's innovative, and it's fun. At least, that's what I want it to be. So this is a show dedicated to motorsports, power sports, and the off-road lifestyle. We're gonna add in a whole bunch of guests, but what I'm trying to do while we add in those guests is really dig into their life. So racers, we don't wanna hear about last weekend's race or next weekend's race. We wanna understand what it takes to be a racer, how much their prep is, what their innovation is into their vehicle, how they get to the races, and then what they do on the fun, right? What they do for fun on the good side. And then we're gonna talk to a company. Companies, yeah, we could talk to the fluffy marketing guy or the sales guy that's on the phone, but that's not who we want to talk to. We're going to talk to the engineer, the one that is responsible for building the products, the ones that understands the A, B, and C of innovation. So where you can listen and go, oh, okay, that makes a ton of sense, and actually learn something from the segment. Then we're going to talk to an event group. Somebody that leads the event, manages the event, and understand all the different layers. I go to so many different events and there's so much fun stuff that happens at them. And it just boggles my mind that every single time I'm like, I didn't know about that, and I didn't know about that, and I didn't know about this. We're gonna allow these events to have a voice, tell us all their different layers, tell us what they got going on, and it should be a ton of fun. Hopefully, you'll add a couple of these to your bucket list of places where you need to go. I'm gonna really try and add a girl into every show, and it's not just because I'm a girl, but because I think that there's a lot of forward push here with ladies trying to get into the industry, and also they also bring up the youth into our scenario, into our group, and give them some ideas of how to be successful in the future. So it could be a racer, it could be an industry leader, you never know, but we'll get their perspective on what's going on. Land use, it's a word y'all hate. Let's just be really dead honest about it. The minute I say land use, you go, oh man, can I fast forward through that section? But I'm gonna take it a little bit differently. I want to understand and talk to people that are on the ground, that are the ones fighting for our land, and for them to tell us how they're doing it. Tell us what their fight is. Tell us why they have to fight. Tell us how they're fighting. With that being said, you may find something that sparks and say, oh, you know, I could go do that, or I could help with this. If we don't take a stand on our land, we won't have any ability to go jeeping. We won't have any ability to go racing. We won't have any ability to go out and about and have fun. So these little 5 to 7 minute segments that the land use group will come in on, I'm pretty much gonna hand them the floor. I'm going to let them talk their talk and listen and learn a whole bunch of different angles to the land use fight. Our Oh Wow section, we're working on this. It's developing. You can be a part of it if you want. This is where we are going to talk about controversy, something just out of the norm. It could be industry related. It could be just normal related. Pet peeve. You could have the floor on this. You can submit your Oh Wow segments to our website at BauerPowerHour.com. And then we're going to talk about Texan tools. So 30-pack Matt's going to come on. He's going to pick something every single week and give you some tool information or some tech tips that hopefully you can find beneficial in your shop or in your home garage. So those are the segments to it. It's very interactive, though. I need your help. I want your help. I want you to hang out. I want you to be part of this. And we have a Facebook page, an Instagram page, a Twitter page, and a website, all of which you can interact with. You can also interact with our guests. So we'll be taking questions ahead of time where it becomes what we call our Powerball game. You'll submit your questions. We'll get them all together. We'll dig out the numbers out of a bucket, and if your question gets picked as one of the three that we ask the guests during the week, then you will win a Bauer Power Hour very fancy t-shirt and a couple gifts that come along with it in the mail. So when you fill out your Powerball questions, make sure you're putting your name and address and your t-shirt size. It's defaulting to small, and I don't think all you all are, so make sure you look through the entire thing. There is some question about how Bauer Power Hour came about, and here's the real deal, you guys. It was not my idea. We'll just start with that. I'm not going to take any effort into saying that it was my idea. Essentially, I didn't want to do it, but I think this is an awesome outlet. So back in November, I got a call from a radio station. Hey, Charlene, we need a news show. Can you do it for us? And I'm like, just really don't have the time, really have a lot going on. So then I had an internet TV station call me and say, hey, Charlene, we really need a news show. Can you help us out? And I'm like, oh, no, really don't have the time. But, you know, sincerely appreciate these calls. They called me a couple weeks later. They're still trying to get me to do it. I'm like, oh, really don't see how it can work right now. And then in February, I got an awesome opportunity. And I'm like, you know, I need to go put my media plan together and really figure this out. And this opportunity demanded voice. It demanded my personality. It demanded understanding what I was going to do. You know, we have awesome print magazines. We have awesome internet outlets. We have great TV for the off-road, but it's all produced. So, you know, they have their own storyline. They have their set of route that they go, and that's cool, but we don't really have anything that has the breaking news. So here we are. I said, okay, there's definitely a hole. And a couple weeks later, the guy called me back from the radio station saying, hey, there's been a change. We really need you. We have a great opportunity. I said, okay, let me call the internet TV guy. We put the whole scenario together. And you guys, it's been a long road. I'm not gonna lie. It's not always been the easiest road, but we have this very fancy studio in my office. This is the desk I do work at every single day. This is my computer that I work on every single day. It was the only way this was gonna work. And so we're bringing you the news every week right here from Bauer Media's world headquarters, as we like to joke around and say. But honestly, it is, right? It's world headquarters. This is where we're at. So that is the backdrop to Bauer Power Hour and the ability that we have in order to bring you this great content. I'm really, really excited about it. It's going to be out on 6 different podcast outlets and more as we can develop it. I want to put it in a position where you can find it. We'll be on different internet outlets. It'll be on YouTube, the internet TV scenario, on radio. So hopefully, again, go to BauerPowerHour.com. You can see all of our outlets and find one that works for you consistently. We will be releasing a new show every Monday, so watch for that. With that being said, let's roll on to the calendar. The calendar has been very, very, very busy in June. June is never a dull month by any means. Some of the things that hit my list: Baja 500, Dirt Riot. We got through all of round twos, Ultra 4 regionals. They all started gearing up. Plus we had Torque, we had Lores, Speed Energy had a couple races, and King of Italy was in Italy. King of the Hammers series. Shows Unlimited Off-Road Expo, they had their second event this year. And then events, Bantam Jeep Festival, we'll start talking about that a little bit later. We got Jeep Jamborees, and I see a lot of people starting their way into the Ultimate Adventure. So there's so many local events that go on as well. If you don't have a Bauer Media calendar on your wall that has all the hot events that are happening, make sure you go to BauerMediaCalendar.com and you can see all of the events that happen across the country. We also have a email blast that comes out every week that gives you the race results from the week before and the events coming up. So our kids calendar, we have a couple more days left in June. Make sure you take advantage of it. We definitely want to get you and your kids registered for an Axial RC car. What? An Axial RC car? Yes, I just said that. So your kids have to color the coloring calendar. You post them up on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, put the picture up, and then we go through, find all the hashtags by the end of the month, and draw for a winner of an Axial RC car. Pretty exciting. July. Well, it's already July. I do not understand how time goes so fast. July is a little bit mellower in the off-road world. There's still a lot of racing going on, a lot of events. But July 4th weekend, which is what we're coming up on right now, it's dead. We all know we're out having a good time. So I thought I would geek out instead and be a historian for a moment and remind us about what July 4th is. So remember, July 4th goes back to 1776, when 13 colonies gained independence from Great Britain. On July 2nd, the Continental Congress voted in favor of the independence, and 2 days later adopted the Declaration of Independence, a document drafted by Thomas Jefferson. So now, July 4th is always celebrated as the birth of American independence, and this has been a federal holiday since 1941, a whole whopping 74 years of having the day off, cooking, barbecue, and hanging out in the pool or going wheeling with your friends. So whatever you're planning on doing this July 4th weekend, I hope that you're doing something fun and something safe, and we definitely will be here as well. We got some exciting plans stirred up to go wave our flag while we're having we put some of our tires in the dirt. All right, are you guys ready for this week's show? Well, I'm definitely excited. We're gonna go to our first guest, brought to you by Discount Tire.
When you're driving down the road, the last thing you want to think about is tires. Trust Discount Tire to get you up to speed with the right tire for your vehicle. We carry the world's best brands of tires, all at everyday low prices. At Discount Tire, we're not just about tires, we're about people. We'll get you the right tire for your vehicle to help keep you safe on the road. Stop by any Discount Tire store for a free air pressure and tire safety check. Your low price journey starts here. Discount Tire.
And we have Jason Shear on the phone with us right now. Hello, Jason. How are you today?
I'm doing great, Charlene. Thanks for having me.
Good. So excited to have you on. I mean, your honors and awards, when we looked at it, 2006, 2007 Pro Rock Champion, 2009 King of the Hammers winner, 2012 and 13 Ultra 4 National Championship Race winner, 2013 Stampede winner, and you left off a couple of fastest qualifiers for King of the Hammers on there, too.
Yeah, a couple of pole positions there, but who's counting, right?
Yeah. Well, fastest guy out of the gate. I mean, that's just as important in a race like King of the Hammers, is it not?
Oh, I don't know. I'd much rather have a lot more wins than poles, but you know, that's always been kind of proof that our cars are good and you know, our team builds stuff really well. It's just that's a tough race to win. It's actually probably, in my opinion, the toughest race to win because of all the different things that are thrown at you and everything you go through in order to be able to make that that long loop come to, you know, fruition for a win.
Yeah. So walk us through getting ready for a typical race. And a typical race for you right now, I'm going to say, is King of the Hammers. But then we also have the Ultra 4 Series. How does that work for you?
Honestly, it's really insane how much goes into getting ready for the races. You know, I sometimes wish we were driving in, you know, a different sport every once in a while because these cars are so much prep. And, you know, that's one of the reasons that I'm taking a little time off this season because we're really, when we go to the race, we want to know that everything was inspected and everything's perfect, or I feel like we're wasting our time and money. So, you know, we put about 200 hours into prep before each race, and honestly, it's almost overwhelming.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It took away from family time, and after, you know, after doing that for so long and really, you know, needing to hire a full-time guy to be able to work in the shop and get things ready, which just never really was a reality for us. We just sort of focused on the main events that we wanted to go to. And, you know, KOH is obviously the event that we really put the most focus on, with going down and testing and making sure we're in good shape, and then taking the car down all the way and going through every single part, making sure everything's in perfect condition to be ready for the race.
Yeah, and it's, I mean, there's nothing, no part of that that's an easy task. And especially you guys, I mean, Jason, you've honestly really put a ton of technology and innovation, especially into this new car. Every car that you've owned, honestly, has been at the front end of it, right? So walk us through some of that and how your mind thinks going forward.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. I mean, you know, I don't know if we're as innovative today as we were originally. I mean, when the sport first started, you know, we went from the rock crawling thing, and I got a really lucky situation. I got to go race class 17 with Mike Schaefer, Lance Clifford, and,
yeah,
you know, won some Baja 1000s with those guys, and then got a chance to go ride in a trophy truck in 2007. And then in 2008, I rode in Jeff Mello's Jeep and went and did King of the Hammers and said, wow, this is so fun. So turned to Shannon Campbell and had him build me a buggy that we, you know, kind of did a go fast setup that we could also go do the rock crawling series with. It was a combo rig, and we put a lot of innovation into it. You know, it was an LS7 powered car with Spider Tracks axles that were really lightweight, and you know, I tried to make it go fast on air shocks, and it wouldn't work. And so, you know, got a ton of support from guys like Fox that said, "Hey, let's go out in the desert and see what it takes to make that car go through the desert fast." And they stood by me while we did that. And we basically showed up in 2009 and 2010, and, you know, we were smoking fast. And then, you know, we saw some of the guys that have really, you know, stepped up. I mentioned Shannon Campbell being one of those guys. I mean, he built the IFS stuff first, along with Brian Kirby and Dave Cole. You know, Brian Kirby built that car, and I got to drive it Vegas to Reno, which we won that year for our class. And, you know, really saw where the stuff was going, and I always tried to make everything that we did is, you know, really as high quality as we could. And, a lot of that came from the desert racing stuff and seeing what those guys were doing and trying to emulate that as much as we could. And the other part of it was just flat out going down there and driving and testing and finding out where the weak points were. So it's a combo of all those things, but I love doing it. If I had an unlimited budget right now, I've got more ideas than that. You know, and a lot of them are probably just things that people are doing in Pro 4 with the transmissions and
right,
all that stuff. But, you know, if I could do it, I'd be there in a heartbeat doing that stuff still.
Yeah, but you kind of just did that with your recent Ultra 4 IFS build. Like, you really took it out of the box. You went a completely different direction and proved it.
Yeah, I mean, the car is fast and it's awesome to drive, you know, but it's when you look at all the stuff, it's not really one thing. I mean, it's sort of elementary. Everything's just, hey, it's low center of gravity, it's light, it's, you know, things are mounted down as low as you can in the car, and it's got as good a ground clearance as you can possibly make. And I have to thank guys like Dallas at Wild West Off-Road to, you know, do the CAD drawings with me to make sure everything would fit and clear and get all the suspension geometry right so that stuff would work. And then, you know, all the fabricators that go into it, and that part of it where you're like, okay, let's go do this, you know, this is going to be a little bit different, you know, radiators instead of passengers inside the car so that they're not up in the window and you're not swinging 100 pounds over the, you know, center line and stuff. And, you know, it's it is a lot of little things. It's not like one big thing. You're like, oh, that was revolutionary. It's just this little stuff. And, you know, the car's fast as can be. That's what's great about it. It's as fast as I can drive. I think as I get a little older, my vision's not as good as it used to be, and I just don't know if I can go any faster than it goes all the time. So I'm pretty happy with that car for sure.
Awesome. Well, what is your proudest racing moment, talking about going fast?
You know, that's a good one. It's probably, it's you know, really it goes back a ways. In 2007, Lance Clifford was my spotter, and I remember going to Farmington, New Mexico. It was a rock crawling. It was the U-Rock rock crawling event, and we didn't know it at the time, but it ended up being the last U-Rock event ever. It was a one-day event, winner-take-all. It was on a Saturday, and we basically knew that the pro-rock event was going on Sunday in Southern California. So we went, okay, we got to load up the trailer on the last obstacle. So, I mean, we pulled off the last obstacle, drove it into the trailer, jumped in the truck, hauled all the way to California all night long to get there, and we didn't even know we won the event. We were about an hour and a half into the ride, and everybody else had finished all their obstacles. Get the call that we won, we're like totally pumped, and get down to Cougar Buttes in Johnson Valley there, and we go out there, and we actually won the event on the Pro Rock event, and then we also won the championship. So nice. You know, it was like a three trophy weekend. It was a total celebration. We had a great time, and you know, we were exhausted afterwards, but we were pretty cool to do it all and had a lot of fun with that. Those are good times. That was definitely one of the most memorable weekends for sure.
Nice. Well, you've really been around a lot of the key industry people, racing as a co-driver, working with them as a driver. I know this is kind of going to be a hard one, but who do you look up to as a hero in the industry or somebody that's really affected the way that you race or that you build your cars?
Oh yeah, you know, that's a great question. Actually, this year at King of the Hammers, I sort of had a dream come true, and it was the circumstance I wouldn't have really ever imagined would happen, but you know, I got a chance to go out and pre-run for 2 days with Rob Mack, and he's been my hero since I was little, and I, you know, tried to watch everything he's ever done out there, and you know, watching, I mean, he's really one of the most successful racers of all time, and you know, to be able to go out and have him in the car, you know, just spend time with him. I mean, he's probably the world's nicest guy. You'd never know in a million years, like, you know, that he's had all this success until you see his dedication and everything he puts into it. I mean,
agreed.
He went to King of the Hammers, and he tried to study every single thing he could about the race. It wasn't like he just showed up and said, oh, yeah, I'm getting to drive a car, you know, for Poison Spider, and that's it. He put everything he could into it, pre-running, spending all day out there, learning every technique he could, really putting forth, you know, all the effort into it, and you're like, wow, that's just amazing, so awesome. And then, you know, it's hard to think about what has happened recently, but what Kyle LeDuc has done in Pro 4, I think, is probably one of the most amazing things also. I mean, those cars are so close together, and, you know, it's such a mature sport as far as, you know, everybody knows, you know, the suspension geometry has to be the same, the frame's the same, everything's got to be all specced out, and he's gone out there, and I think he just won 7 in a row, but he won, you know, more than half the events last year, and you look at it and you're like, oh, it's just an incredible record. So you know, I'm just amazed to see that, and really, you know, stoked to see that for guys. It gives you kind of that inspiration that it's possible to do it, you know. And then you mentioned as a fabricator, you know, I got really lucky when I was able to buy Tiny from John Nelson and Pops, and see all the innovation of, you know, how he did things a certain way, not just to follow what everybody else had done. And, you know, it really lets you know it's okay to think outside the box, and you know, go after those things in order to build the car so that it works as well as possible. You don't just have to do what the other guys are doing. And that helped me a lot with trying to build a new car like that. And like I said before, you know, Shannon building the IFS cars, and really, you know, he sort of led the revolution on Ultra 4 since day one. And, you know, you got to really hand it out to him and his whole family for everything that they've put into the sport. And then, you know, in our series, Lauren, what he's done is really fantastic. You know, he's got the most wins of everybody in our season, in our series, sorry. Yeah, he's won the most races.
Right.
And,
right.
You know, he sort of came out of nowhere, and he just pulled it off. I mean, that's really a cool thing to see happen, too, in a sport where you've got people that can just go out there and still, you know, learn everything from day one and go out there and have the most wins. So, got to hand it to him as well.
Yeah, well, you have like an awesome display of racing, but you also have an awesome family and you love to trail wheel on the weekends and you got a daughter and a son and a wife. And what are some of your exciting, memorable events on the trail?
Yeah, you know, trail wheeling is sort of the root of it. When I was young, I had a friend of mine's family that had a Jeep, and they took us out on the Barrett Lake Jeep Trail, and we rode our dirt bikes on the trail, and they took the Jeep, and, you know, it sort of just gave me that feeling like, you know what, this is a great place to raise your family. You get to spend time together, and it's really fun. You know, the whole time you're having a great time doing all parts of it, and so, you know, I wanted that to be a big part of my family life as well, and, you know, we go out all the time. I try to support all the trails and keep things open and dedicate time. I was really fortunate to be part of, like, some of the Friends of Fordyce stuff and, you know, BlueRibbon, you know, lifetime member, top four lifetime member, and, you know, involved in my Jeep club and all that stuff. And it really, you know, I look at that and just enjoy the recreational side of it. It's so different than racing, but, you know, it's such a great time to spend with the family. You know, I mean, just it's kind of like, you know, time away from everything else. So you just focus on your kids and your wife, and, you know, show them how to do all these little things, whether it's fishing or setting up a tent. You know, it's just all parts of it I love. And, you know, the wheeling part's really fun too. But for me, it's just spending time with the family. So I love doing that.
All right. And here's something that not a lot of people know about you. And where were you married?
Well, you know, that one I got to give my wife a lot of credit for letting me do it. But she let me get married on the Rubicon Trail, which was awesome. And, you know, we had about 70 of our best friends come out there, and I got all the grandparents out there thanks to the, you know, helicopters flying them in, my friends running them from the airport to our little secret campground where we got did our vows and everything, and a good friend of mine, Bob Rice, got ordained in order to do the ceremony, and we just had a blast. It was really fun, and I always look back at that as just such a great thing, and we're about to celebrate 10 years this August. So,
oh, wow, congratulations.
You know, yeah, thank you. Yeah, no, it was great. And I tried to talk her into going there for our 10-year anniversary, but we made some other plans to go do some fun stuff up in Oregon, camping together. So I'll talk her into it one day this summer to go back to the spot we got married to enjoy it.
Nice. Well, you drive just about everything fast, don't you? So you have dirt bikes and snowmobiles and do all kinds of fun stuff. But what's the one pet peeve that you have when you're on the highway?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. I think, you know, just people not being focused is, like, my most, you know, I really can say this. As soon as the texting and you know, laws came into effect, I think it became really apparent to me that when people were on their phone, they were also driving really poorly, and I didn't really notice it as much before, but, yeah, I can't believe every time I seem to get behind the guy going 50 in the fast lane or making bad moves, and you look over and he's on his phone, you're like, no way. So, you know, I know that it's impossible to get everybody to be focused, but I'd rather see, you know, people just be more aggressive and drive, you know, than just sit there and tailgate each other and drive, you know, without really paying attention. But, you know, I don't think that's the reality of the world we live in anymore. But
so do you nerf them, or do you go around nicely?
Oh, you know, I've gotten a little bit more respectful as I've gotten older, I think, and, you know, plus, you know, it's just one of those things where, you know, I don't really want to go, you know, wheeling by people and end up getting tickets either, but I'm pretty focused.
That's
in
awesome.
Fact, I don't, you know, knock on wood, I don't have a lot of tickets because I drive so focused, I kind of see where everybody is, even though I probably average like 80 on the freeway all the time, but, you know, around town, I drive like a grandma. I almost feel like, you know, people have no idea how hard it is to stop from 25, 30 miles an hour when you're in a neighborhood. So, you know, I'm like one of those people that, you know, probably goes almost under the speed limit when they're driving around town. But, you know, it's just a focus on driving. It drives me crazy when people don't, you know, be aggressive enough to make good moves for sure.
And the big question, zip ties or duct tape?
Oh, I'm a big zip tie fan for sure.
So what's the most important thing that you've held on with a zip tie?
You know, I will tell you a funny one. This year at King of the Hammers, I had the Zeus fasteners came off that mount the hood, and I had to, like, jump out of the car. I had a little pallet or a little stack of zip ties that we zip tie about 20 of them to the roll cage that are open, so you can just grab one if you needed it for something, and I had to run that back through the hood to hold the hood down because I was cruising along at like 70 miles an hour, and bam, the hood goes up, and I couldn't see anything for a second. I was like, ah! So, yeah, no, it's probably zip ties, and that may be the most important. I'm sure I've had more, but I can't think of them right now.
Nice. Well, thanks, Jason. I really appreciate you taking the time to call in and talk with us.
Thank you, Charlene. I'm glad to be part of the show, and be happy to be on anytime you want me.
Thank you, definitely. And now we're going to roll into our next guest, brought to you by Kicker Audio, fueled for living loud.
If you drive a utility vehicle, Jeep, or motorcycle, Kicker Audio has the power sports stereo gear to entertain you at any location. The gear is compact, weatherproof, and provides you with great sounding music wherever the job or fun takes you. See your authorized Kicker dealer for your off-road tunes.
Now, let's welcome Greg Mulkey from Raceline Wheels. Hi, Greg. How are you doing today?
All right, Charlene. It's good to be here. It's a busy time for all of us in the off-road industry.
Oh, my goodness, isn't it, though? So, Raceline Wheels, really, and obviously, it's a wheel company, but what is Raceline known for the most?
Well, Raceline has been around about almost 18 years. The biggest part of Raceline Wheels is the Raceline is the aluminum divisions. And we also have Allied Wheel, which is a parent company, which has for years built trailer tires and wheel assemblies. And most people who buy trailers out there have our trailers and tires on them.
And,
we expanded the company about 15 years ago into the aluminum market. And so we built truck and SUV wheels. We build the, all the small car wheels. And we developed a racing division, which I started 15 years ago. And been designing a lot of beadlock wheels, so I think currently we're around 22 countries selling beadlock wheels right now.
Really, 22 countries? That's really impressive. So how did the beadlock wheel come about? You said you developed the racing series 15 years ago. Is that all part of it, or?
Well, no, I actually started when I was 14 years old for a company called Marsh Racing Tires back in Arkansas, and my first part of my career at 14 was, grunt work and then slowly working my way up through the processes and getting into sales and development. And in 1979, we designed and built the very first beadlock that anybody had ever seen. And most of the time there, we were dirt track racing. We didn't get into desert racing until the mid-80s when we were working with Mickey Sr. and Walker and all the guys that were desert racers back then. So beadlocks, been around since 79, been doing a lot of them.
So what's the benefit to a beadlock over a different style wheel?
Well, that's a good question. A lot of people ask that question all the time. They mostly want to know, why a beadlock isn't legal. And the second question is do I need beadlocks? And so that's the two most popular questions I get asked. In answer to the first question, why are beadlocks illegal? Really, on the books, there's not a law that states that beadlock wheels are illegal. What the law states is that any wheel operating on a publicly funded road must conform to DOT rim shell shape configuration, which was a law that was established in the 30s. So I don't think anybody's looked back at that since then. And of course, a beadlock doesn't conform to that, and so that's where the sticky part gets. It's not that they're illegal, or it's not that they're unsafe in any means when they're used correctly, but that's kind of that. And then the second question, people ask, well, why would I need a beadlock? For the most part, in general, for off-roading, you don't need a beadlock wheel. It's just when you want to run the air pressures low and you want to start scaling rock faces or dirt faces or whatever it is that takes the angle up toward the sky.
Okay.
And they need to lower air pressure because when you look at a rim wheel, a rim shell, you'll notice that on one part of the back side of the rim has a big bell, which normally would fit over the brakes, and the front part of the rim has a small shelf with a valley in the middle of it. And the valley is there so that it makes it easy to mount tires because the OD of the ring, let's say a 15-inch wheel, the OD of that rim is 16 inches, so you have to be able to slide that tire down over, and that's where the valley comes into view. So when everybody started lowering air pressures, of course, the little shelf on the front, you only had to push the tire an inch and a half, and it fell into the valley, and you would lose the air, and we would have a flat tire on the trail. So beadlocks were designed to actually bolt the tire bead to the wheel so that the tire and the wheel becomes one, so that you can't push it off that little shelf anymore. And so they can now run lower air pressures and can conform to whatever obstacle that they're trying to go over. But for most people that trail ride, that, you know, just go out and run the medium trails, the ones and the twos, and they're not lowering their air pressures below, let's say, 18 PSI, generally they don't need a beadlock wheel. Now, when they start going fast, like desert racing and type stuff like that, where you have the opportunity that you hit things and could knock the bead off the wheel, then that's another place where the beadlock comes into an advantage. So that's kind of the gist on beadlocks.
Gotcha. Now, you brought up air pressures, and that's also a very common question that you get asked. Give us just like the rough piece on air pressures.
Well, in my experience, you know, a lot of people think lower air pressure is better, and it's not. You get to a line where when you lower the air pressure so far that it ends up concaving the center of the tread inward toward the wheel, and it actually closes up the grooves in the tires. Mm-hmm. So you actually end up just riding on the outside edges. You know, let's say a 35-inch tall tire on an average trail riding rig, really 20 to 16 PSI, they're going to be able to handle anything that they might come across. It's like I say, it's only when you start doing the inclines and the big rocks and stuff like that, or speed, that you really need to pay attention to the air pressures. But, you know, if a guy just out trail riding wants to stay in the 18 to 24 pounds with a stock Toyota, a stock Jeep, whatever he's got, he's going to get plenty of traction, and he's not going to cause the tire to fold in where it closes up the grooves.
Got it. So you're bringing up desert racing a couple different times and going fast, and you just developed a new wheel for that. What was the technology? What was the innovation? What was the thought process that you put into developing that that wheel?
Well, since 79, so we're, you know, I hate to give away my age, but, you know, 4 years of beadlocks, you know, you've learned and you've seen a lot of things. And in the desert racing, especially like the Ultra 4, which is the most extreme that I've been involved with, where the guys are, you know, 100 plus miles per hour across the desert and then going up into the mountains and climbing over boulders bigger than the cars. So for those there, you really have to keep your ingenuity toward strength in the wheel without making the wheel weigh so much that it robs the horsepower from the car because of the unsprung weight. So in 17-inch wheels, you come up with a recipe that's anywhere from 36 to 46 pounds of material. Mm-hmm. You can build a wheel that will hold up to generally about everything except for flat tires and you know, crashing and burning and rolling and putting the dirty side up. So a lot goes into it. You know, a lot of it is done right out at, you know, we go out to the races and we put them on cars and we purposely let all the air out of the tires and we just beat the wheels and the vehicles into the rocks to find out where the weak points are. And then we go back and we work on those weak points. And over the 30 years of time, we've developed a few wheels that are really holding up well, and you see them all the time in the desert.
Yeah, so that was one of my questions too, is how do you do your R&D and what's the time to market and how do you test the products before you bring them out?
You know, a lot of it is, we, you know, with the products that we have now, it's impossible to build or claim that you can build a wheel that's indestructible. So when you are in the field and someone does roll and does bend or break a wheel, you want to be, us as innovators, we want to be there, see what happened, talk to the driver, find out if he realized what happened, and then try to ascertain if that certain failure or breakage can be fixed, or if it's just basically a racing thing and, you know, you can just do so much with things and before they fail. So with all that in mind, it is a step-by-step, just being there, watching wheels run. I have testing facilities that we do here in-house where we test the strength of the centers by trying to break the centers out of the wheels. We try to crush the rim shells. And all that's done with a PSI gauge, and we watch that gauge. And then we make changes, and we put it in there, another one, and we we crush them and we just make notes and we get to a recipe that actually works real well. It's amazing how many little fine things that you can do, fine adjustments that make a big difference on the finished product.
Yeah, you guys actually have quite a manufacturing facility right there in California. What are all the elements that you put together?
Well, here at Garden Grove, the headquarters of Raceline Wheels, like I said, we test here. We also use standard testing laboratories and other laboratories that have been testing wheels since, you know, wheels were wheels. And they were built out of either metal of some kind. And so we do as much as we can here in-house. And then, of course, there's always computer-generated. They have technologies now where you can actually put your parameters into the computers and you can run the wheels, although I've yet to see one of those guys design a system that would test the wheel the same as we beat him up out of the King of the Hammers.
Right. So with all the testing, race-proven, Raceline wheels, right? Now what you're offering your everyday consumer is something that is super strong.
That's correct. Super strong and as light as possible because the unsprung weight is horsepower, gas mileage, however you want to look at it. It takes, I think the computer generation tells you that for every pound of weight you put on the axle that spins, it makes the car think it's 10 pounds heavier. Hmm. So if you had a 40-pound wheel and you had it on all four corners, that's 1,600. So the car thinks it's 1,600 pounds. Well, let's say you take and remove 10 pounds of weight from each wheel and you bring it down to 30 pounds. Now you're down to 1,200 pounds. The car thinks it's 400 pounds lighter. That's in braking, steering, and accelerating.
Yeah.
The 10-to-1 ratio.
Huh. And, wow, that's a lot of weight. That has a lot to do with the entire geometry of the vehicle from the front to back.
There's no doubt, you know, in the suspension, how you valve your shocks.
Yeah.
The amount of pressure you put in the power steering systems to turn them, you know, because the gyrostic effect of something spinning in one direction is hard to change that direction. And so the lighter the weight, the easier it is to make those adjustments, either with the throttle, steering wheel, or the brake pedal.
And that's just as important for the guy driving the JK on the trail as you went across the country last year joining all these guys at different events, you know, trying to teach them this technology, right?
Well, gas mileage is gas mileage. So, you know, if you you can take a rotating mass off of the axles, you're definitely going to get better gas mileage. And if you're up on the Black Ribbon driving across the country, gas mileage is a big deal.
Yeah. I definitely agree with that, and you do as well. So you did spend quite a few miles on the road last year, going event to event. And I have to ask you, what has been your favorite event that you have visited, been a part of, wheeled out?
That's a tough question for me because I've been in the industry a long time, so I've got to go to a lot of great big races and have a lot of great times, but one of the trails that we did last year was Canyon de Chelly in Arizona, where it was an old Anastasi ruins and stuff where the Anastasi Indians grew up. And it was a trail that, you know, it was two different days, and they took you back in there, and it was the most beautiful country. You'd be surprised just how beautiful some of that country is in Arizona. But down there at Canyon de Chelly was, I believe it's Chinle, Arizona, was just a beautiful place. You know, and other than that, when you get back to the East Coast, like in the Smoky Mountains, there's Teleco and Jellicoe. Those are all awesome, awesome trails to go and be a part of. And I got to say, last year, or I guess it was this year, for Jeep Beach was just a really good time. For no mountains and no rocks, there's sure a lot of Jeeps down there.
Yeah, we definitely had a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Definitely had a lot of fun.
And then you guys, you all just got back from Bantam. I sure wish we could have made it out there this year, but instead the world record for Jeeps in a parade. And so, you know, there's a lot of cool stuff going in the off-road industry for people that just want to trail ride. You don't have to be someone that wants to go out and climb the tallest mountain. There's so many beautiful trails. you know, we're entered in the RallyVenture this year, and that's a really cool event that's all based off GPS. And I know that you did the course at Moab, and
yeah.
I think that's something that's coming that everybody can really enjoy, too. It's kind of like a scavenger hunt for us four-wheeled guys.
Yep. We're going to talk to Jeff here in just a few minutes, actually. He's going to tell us all about it. It's exciting. Yeah. It's going to be a great event.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
So you kind of gave up your age just a little bit, but I'm going to kind of dig here for a minute. What's a piece of advice that you would give to the next generation of inventors or people that are going to come in and mix it up here in the off-road industry a little bit?
Well, the same rule that I've always used, and that is don't just go full bore into it. Kind of kick back on the fringes and watch. And watch for the people that you can tell that know what they're doing and learn from them and pay attention, because you can learn a lot by watching guys that have experience on the trails a lot easier than you can go out and try to learn it yourself. So my advice would be is just to kind of hang with some of the guys that's been doing it a while and learn their good habits and ignore their bad habits.
And
the bad habits is always the heavy left foot. When in doubt, powering out is always not the right decision to make.
As you just got your race car going in, what, race last year? Year before
last?
No,
it's been 3 years since I ran the King of the Hammers.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's the first time in my 40 years of being in the off-road industry and racing industry building wheels that I ever decided to put a uniform on.
Yep.
I always figured, it was always told that to own a race car, you'd spend all the dimes you had and all the dimes your friends had, and for long you wouldn't have no dimes and you wouldn't have no friends either. So I've kind of always steered clear of having a race car.
All right, so here is the ultimate question. Are you ready?
Okay.
Duct tape or zip ties?
I've used them both many times.
Okay,
they
so
both
what's,
have advantages.
What's the most important thing that you've held on with duct tape or zip ties?
Golly, I couldn't list all the things that I put 100 mile an hour race tape on. And they don't, and I can tell you for sure, they never a big enough zip tie.
Oh, it's awesome. Greg, thank you so much for joining us today. Awesome information as always. So if you guys want to learn more about the whole product line of Raceline wheels, you can go to racelinewheels.com. They also have a Facebook page and an Instagram page. Final word, Greg?
Well, you know, everybody go out and be a part of the off-road nation. It's the greatest nation on the planet. And just remember to always be safe and keep the rubber on the ground.
Awesome. Well, we'll talk to you soon. And now we're going to join Del Albright from the Blue Ribbon Coalition for a few words about off-roading and our land fight. Brought to you by BF Goodrich Tires. Are you driver enough?
Are you driver enough to handle the ultra-high performance of the new BF Goodrich G-Force Comp 2 all-season tire or the rugged toughness of the all-terrain TAK02? From August 31st to September 27th, get a $50 or $70 MasterCard reward card after submission when you buy a set of four new BF Goodrich passenger or light truck tires. Head to your local BF Goodrich dealer today. See redemption form for complete offer details. Offer expires 9/27/2015. Void where prohibited. Reward card issued by U.S. Bank pursuant to license from MasterCard International Incorporated.
Well, hello, Del. How are you doing today?
Hi, Charlene. I am doing great. It's nice to be here.
Yeah, well, you know, first of all, I just want to say thank you for all of yours and Stacy's hard work and dedication. You're at all the events and more events that I'm at. You're out there beating the trail and making sure that, you know, people have the understanding of what's going on in our land war, as you call it. And I really just want to hand over the mic to you and let you talk, because you have so many great things to say. I just don't even want to get in the middle of it.
You mean, unaccustomed as I am to public speaking, you want me to just start talking?
I think you're one of the best.
You know, all the people that work in land use, we couldn't do what we do if we didn't have people like you and your whole organization supporting, filming, talking about us, because everything we do to save trails amounts to people, you know, spreading the word, and that's something you do very well.
Yeah.
And I'm honored to be here.
Thank you.
As you know, I'm Blue Ribbon Coalition is behind Saving Trails, and that's me and Cal 4 Wheel and a bunch of others. But yeah. I thought today we would talk about the most often asked question that I get, and that has to do, imagine that, with the Rubicon Trail.
Oh, great. Okay. One of my favorites. People, love it.
Yeah. Well, everybody does, and for years and years and years, almost 16 years, we've been fighting and working to make sure that trail stays open for everybody forever.
Yep.
And I thought I would share the tricks, tips, and tap dances of how we made that happen and how it applies to trails all across the country, private and public, because this formula I'm going to share with you is straightforward, it's simple, and it works. And that's how we saved the Rubicon. It has to do with the four E's. E as in Edward. And actually, lately I've been calling it E as in light, enlightenment. Because when we had the Rubicon proposed, the people around it, the county and the state proposed a gate in 2001, they said they were going to gate the Rubicon. Well, a bunch of us stood up and said, no, we're about land use, we're about saving trails, we're about, you know, this is our backyard, we're going to keep the Rubicon open, you know, get out of the way and tell us what needs to be fixed. That's kind of a simple approach we took, but that's what we did. And the trick was these four E's I'm going to talk about briefly, because anybody can use this, any organization, any trail, OHV parks, public lands, it doesn't matter. These work. The first one is engineering. What I tell people is when you look at a trail, and from a land use perspective, from an environmental perspective, you know, the engineering of what went into that trail, was there some risk management done? Did people look at the water runoff situation, water crossings? How many creeks, you know, will you actually put your tires in? Is the soil stable? Things like that became critical to saving the Rubicon. And in touring back east, I've seen the same thing with private OHV parks. You know, the water runoff and erosion becomes essential. So a well-engineered trail takes that into account right off the bat. Rolling dips and water bars and some of these things you can look up or go to the websites and find them, but like gabions and vegetation management around trails becomes critical. Engineering, we also looked at things like rider conflict. You know, are dirt bikes going to be going the same places that four-wheel drives are going to be going? Will there be ATVs and side-by-sides? And pretty much I can assure you there'll be side-by-sides everywhere. So the engineering aspect takes that into account. And I tell public land managers, you know, let us help you inventory what you've got for roads and trails. And from a land use perspective, you know, we'll show you the ones we like, that the riders like and the wheelers and
right.
that we enjoy. So it's like, you know, let us help you engineer it. And, you know, that's like the first step.
That makes
of
sense.
Any trail system is engineering. Then we jump into education. And you've seen that on the Rubicon where, you know, we have the signs, we have a kiosk, we have brochures, we have people volunteering to hand out, you know, spiel kits, whatever it takes
yep.
to make sure the riders and the wheelers know what, you know, what the trail is about and how to keep it open. And once people understand that, I have found nationwide, once they get the picture, almost everybody will help. Not that we're perfect, but everybody will try and do their part, and education is a key part of that formula. So that's, you've seen the signs on the Rubicon and how to stay on the trail and what not to go in closed areas. You do that as much as you can with any trail system, that's almost a guaranteed success right there. And the third E is enlisting. That means enlisting the help of people who love that trail or OHV park or whatever it is to get involved. With a little bit of training, I had people coming from all over the country to help with the Rubicon, provide leadership, capitalize on their skills. If they were a good welder, I put them to work welding. If they were wounded and could only sit at a table, I put them to work signing people in. If they liked to wield a shovel, I gave them one. So that's, you take people and put their passion to work, enlist their help, let them become part of the solution. Big key to keeping trails open right there, getting people involved.
Got it. Makes sense.
And the last one is enforcement. And by that, you know, it takes rules to do anything anymore in these days. I don't like a lot of rules or bureaucracy, but there has to be some. And some people need to be reminded of the rules. So, like on the Rubicon, we started a volunteer trail patrol. And we made sure people didn't get into confrontational situations, but, you know, with combining education handouts and saying, hey, partner, you're in the wrong spot. You don't belong here. This trail is closed right here. Get back on the trail. You know, you enforce your own rules with people voluntarily. And if that doesn't work, you know, cops. And we did that on the Rubicon to start things off because some people didn't follow the rules, wouldn't listen to our volunteers. So the enforcement meant, you know, some law enforcement officer coming out there giving them a pinch and saying, you know, don't do this again. This is going to cost you money. So when you take those, engineering, education, enlisting people, a little bit of enforcement at the end, the four E's, you end up with a guaranteed formula that'll help keep a system or trail management, whatever, open and sustainable.
Wow.
And as you know,
yep.
Sustaining and sustainable are big words now being used in the federal government and environmental organizations. And if it's sustainable, that means we can keep it open and use it, and it'll sort of recreate itself as we go along. When it becomes unsustainable, they want to close it. So the four E's will help keep a system sustainable, open for everybody, and usable in the long term. That's what
Great.
I'm about.
You know, I think that's excellent to actually bust into our episode one of Bauer Power Hour and in our land use segment here, because as we talk to your different partners that you work with in different segments, you know, this will be fun to see how their engineering, their education, their enlisting, and their enforcements are working in their area and being successful at keeping the trails open for us to utilize. So, no, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Del. And thank you so much for your efforts at keeping the Rubicon Trail open. You know, one of our family favorites. And we just talked to Jason Shearer, who was married there, right? And few others. So everybody has a lot of history on the Rubicon Trail, and sincerely appreciate your time and effort.
Well, and thank you for helping us share how we saved that trail and keep it safe, because people can put this to work, and the Bauer Power Hour is a good place to learn how to do it. Thank you, Charlene.
Awesome. Well, excellent information. Actions are always needed. If you want to reach out to Del, you can go to BauerPowerHour.com. We have all of his contact information there. And Blue Ribbon Coalition is sharetrails.org. So
that's affirmative.
Yeah, awesome. Well, now we are going to move on to some tool and tech time. I can hardly wait to see what we have coming up next.
When you're driving down the road, the last thing you want to think about is tires. Trust Discount Tire to get you up to speed with the right tire for your vehicle. We carry the world's best brands of tires, all at everyday low prices. At Discount Tire, we're not just about tires, we're about people. We'll get you the right tire for your vehicle to help keep you safe on the road. Stop by any Discount Tire store for a free air pressure and tire safety check. Your low price journey starts here. Discount Tire.
Well, I know you guys and gals love tech and tool time, so let's see what 30-pack Matt has in store for us today. How are you doing today?
Great. How are you guys?
Good, good. So what is on the tool and tech schedule for today?
Today we're going to talk about welding and how important it is to do the right steps to make sure you don't warp the piece that you're welding.
Oh, awesome. All right, so what's step one?
Well, step one is realizing that when you weld and when you heat up metal, it makes itself pull in that direction. So whatever side of the piece you weld is going to want to pull that direction. And a lot of people aren't aware of that, or they don't know, or if they are aware, they don't know how much force it'll actually put on a piece. So first step is, you know, real popular mod nowadays with the JK is a truss and gusset the knuckles. And it's extremely important to not overheat the housing, or else you'll, by trying to keep your housing straight, you'll actually destroy it by warping it to a banana shape.
Oh, gotcha. Okay, so then step two?
Step two is when you're working on a piece, whether it's an axle housing or a roll cage or anything else, you don't want to spend too much time in one area as far as welding in a, you know, constant weld or building up too much heat. So you want to move around. So say you do 3 inches on one side, you want to move to the other complete opposite side of the axle on the other end and do another 3 or 4 inches there, and then walk away for a little bit and let it come back down to, doesn't have to be room temperature, but, you know, cool enough to put your hands on without burning you. And then, you know, repeat that step over and over until the whole piece is welded. You know, even doing it that way, you might still get some warpage.
Okay, so that goes back to how to solve kind of step one, how not to get the fold.
Yeah.
All right, so what's step three then?
Step three is just practicing a ton on your start and stops, so that when you start a weld, you can go back into the last weld and make it look just like the previous weld. And you could do that by, on your bench, just, you know, try and weld an inch and then weld an inch right next to it and try and make it look like it was one continuous weld, even though it wasn't. And there's, you know, you can watch YouTube videos, and there's a lot of information out there on YouTube, but a lot of it's just going to be practice and figuring out your weave to pick up where you left off without leaving a big bubble.
What else would you recommend to new welders?
Well, that's, you know, the most important thing is practice, and then that also includes practicing your metal prep. So you just want to make sure that you always have clean surfaces. You know, paint, powder coat are probably the worst things for a weld. So the cleaner, the better. The more comfortable you are, the better. And the more practice you get, the better your welds are going to be.
How do you generally prep the metal for welding? What's some of the techniques that you use?
To prep it?
Uh-huh, the metal.
Anything from 4.5-inch angle grinder with a grinding stone on it, or, you know, an air grinder with a sanding pad or a wire wheel, or, you know, even with powder coat, you actually, the easiest way to get rid of powder coat is to use a torch with a rosebud and actually burn the paint, and you'll see it just, it only takes a couple seconds, it'll turn charcoal, and you can just wire wheel it off. It'll be nice and clean for welding.
So what's one of the tricks of the trade that you do while you're welding that not a lot of people may even know about or think about?
Can't give you all my secrets. I like to focus on, I don't focus on the weld, I focus on the previous puddle, you know, like I don't stare right at the arc, I look at where the arc was, and that's, you know, usually the easiest way to make sure you're staying online. And it's also, you can, you know, your eyes are more adjusted to the surrounding area, so you can see if your weld joint's going to turn, you can tell, and it's just, your eyes aren't focused on such a bright light for such a long time that you can see, it's more clear to see where you're going and what your weld looks like where you were, you know?
Yeah. Makes sense. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being part of our tech and tool time. I think that was a great place to start. Love welding. You do an awesome job at it. And we want to see everybody else's welds too. So send us your pictures on our Facebook, Bauer Power Hour Show. Let's check out your pictures. So that wraps up our first hour of Bauer Power Hour. And you know what? We'll be right back with a whole bunch more guests.
Are you driver enough to handle the ultra-high performance of the new BF Goodrich G-Force Comp 2 all-season tire or the rugged toughness of the all-terrain TAK02? From August 31st to September 27th, get a $50 or $70 MasterCard reward card after submission when you buy a set of four new BF Goodrich passenger or light truck tires. Head to your local BF Goodrich dealer today. See redemption form for complete offer details. Offer expires 9/27/2015. Void where prohibited. Reward card issued by U.S. Bank pursuant to license from MasterCard International Incorporated.
Welcome back to the second hour of Bauer Power Hour, where we still have a lot more action coming to you directly from the Bauer Motorsports Media Studio office. Join the conversation and ask our upcoming guest questions at www.bauerpowerhour.com or on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at Bauer Power Hour Show. And now back to Charlene and this week's guest.
And welcome back to the second hour of Bauer Power Hour. Aren't the guests in the first hour just so intriguing? Every single week is going to be just like this, where we have that A-plus list. We have a whole nother set of guests ready to come on for this hour as well. But I'm going to pick your ear for a minute. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Bauer Media and how we came around. June is actually a very exciting month for me. This is our 6-year anniversary of Bauer Media, when I had this cockamamie crazy idea to start my own business. I have to tell you, I respect every business owner out there, because what we do every day isn't the easiest thing, is it, guys? But we do it and we love it, and I definitely love who we are as a company and all the people that work with me. It's definitely a team environment around here. It's me doing it on the front side, that's what you see a lot, but we also have a lot of people in the backdrop that help me be successful, and that really does matter. So you hear me say we a lot, because truly there is a we, there is a team. There's a lot of people that keep me going forward, and to that I sincerely appreciate. Bauer Media, what are we? Well, we are a PR and marketing firm that works with companies, racers, and events. So we will help a company do all their PR and marketing. We'll write press releases, we'll track their racers, we'll make sure their racers are doing what they're supposed to be doing as well. We'll work with racers, we'll chase them around. It's one of my kind of fun statements that I say, is we love chasing boys around. So we chase them around, we do their press releases, we make sure that they're sponsors are taken care of and represented well, pictures, videos, and the rest of it. And then events, same scenario. We work with a couple of big event series where we do all their PR, all their media, keep their websites running, and everything that you see online is actually coming out of the office here. So a lot of work gets done at this old desk right here, and this is the Bauer Media now studio office. So really excited to come to you from right here. I thought this would be the best and the only way that this show would be successful, is if the news came from the news desk. Bauer Media, we have, I just went and did some numbers because it is June. So we've done 617 YouTube videos as of the first of the month, created thousands and thousands of videos. I did not even know how to count those. Over 700 press releases, which is insane. 37 websites, and we're working on building 4 more right now, along with a whole bunch of other elements that we've done. So some of the company names that you see that are attached to Bauer Media, we call them properties when we're talking about them here in the office, is I'm Not Just a Girl, Race Team Store, Shirt and Swag Club, the Shirt and Bling Club, our Off-Road Newswire. Oh boy, what else do we do? We have our Month of Cause, Inspirational Dirt, and we just really love hanging out with you guys at all the events and covering what's going on in the off-road industry. We do have a weekly newsletter that we'd love for you to be a part of if you're not already. This weekly newsletter comes out every Wednesday. It has the race results from the last weekend and the calendar for the next weekend, so you can really keep up to date with what's going on. You can impress all your buddies by knowing everything. Just use the little cheat sheet and go, well, yeah, don't you know what's going on this weekend? Or yeah, don't you know Jason Scheer won last weekend, right? So you have a lot of fun with that. In addition to that calendar, we do have a print calendar that you can have hanging on your wall. It has all the events with some cool off-road pieces, and an online calendar that has a lot more information at BauerMediaCalendar.com. One of the extensions that we did for this year, which is a lot of fun, is we wanted to talk to the kids. And so we went out and we said, okay, moms, what aren't you going to throw away from an event? And the one thing that kind of kept coming back was coloring books. And I just went ahead and says, you know, we already built a calendar. Let's multi-purpose that. Let's turn it into a coloring calendar for the kids. And so I went and taught myself how to build a coloring book, and by December we had a pretty fancy coloring book out there for all the kids to play with. We've been having so much fun this year with distributing these, getting them into kids' hands, watching them color. But the other half to that is the kids can win an Axial RC car. And we still are getting more and more and more and more kids involved. And I want to make sure that we have your kids involved because it's a super cool program. So, mom and dad, you get the calendar, you have them draw on it. We don't care what it looks like. Coloring's coloring, right? Take a picture of the coloring calendar and your kid, the drawee, right? And post it up on Facebook, post it up on Instagram, post it on Twitter, somewhere where we can find it. It has to be hashtagged with that particular month's hashtag, and you have to make it public. I have to be able to see the picture. A lot of people are posting them, but they're set to private, so watch out. I have to be able to see it. We go and we find them all by the end of the week, or the end of the month, excuse me. We do it weekly, that's why I say that. So we go and find them all by the end of the month, and we do a random draw, and the random draw kid gets shipped a very awesome Axial RC car. So it's been a lot of fun. We've already given 5 away. We're working on the June submissions right now. You still have a couple days left, and then we'll roll into July. So that's our calendar program and getting our kids involved in off-road. But I want to talk about one of the events that we were just at, the Bantam Jeep Festival. This is something that I was given the opportunity to go to with BF Goodrich Tires. They have a program going on right now that I've been able to help them out with. And it is where you get to drive a Jeep JK Rubicon with nothing done to it, with the exception of putting on the brand new BFG KO2 all-terrain tires. So at the beginning of the year, they said, "Hey, Charlene, we really like you to come out to these events and be a right seat." And I'm like, "Oh, I don't know about that. It's kind of, you know, outside my line of doing the media work." And you know what? I've had so much fun with it. Sitting in the Jeep, teaching people how to drive, teaching people about the tires, teaching people new terminology like cleaning a tire means, you know, the mud popping out of the tire while you're still in the mud and how that works. Teaching people new techniques like how to 2-foot through the rock section, because I get to go through the rock section 30 times a day. We're definitely gonna teach people how to 2-foot. A lot of fun there. So I spent 3 days in Bantam in a Jeep going around in circles, meeting all kinds of cool people. But there's a lot more to that event, which is another reason why we're doing our event section on the show so that you guys can kind of understand more and more and more. But I want to dive into a couple of really cool facts that I learned while I was there. So clearly we're in Pennsylvania and there's a ton of history around the whole East Coast as it is. But Bantam Jeep Festival is based around the first Jeep that was ever built. But as I really dug into that, that's not necessarily 100% the theory. So here's the real deal, okay guys? So we were in Butler, Pennsylvania. The original name of the company was the American Bantam Car Company. And in 1940s, World War II era, the military needed a vehicle. They needed a four-wheel drive vehicle. So the American Bantam Car Company was already building cars, and they said, "Oh, okay, well, we'll go to bid on this." And they did. So they built this really cool production vehicle and did all of the drawings. We'll put it up right now. This is the building that the drawings were built in. I found it. I got the insider sneak information and we went and took some pictures. Right next to it is where the first ever quote unquote Jeep was built, but it's actually considered a Bantam. So this is in 1940. Bantam supplied their bid out to the military first. What that actually did then was kind of show everybody else what their theory was. Willys came in right behind them and Ford came in and said, "Hey, well, we wanna work on this bid." And Willys actually ended up getting the military contract because they proved, hey, we have enough effort, we have the right product, and we can, you know, build as many as you need as you want to, where the Bantam facility was a lot smaller. So the look kind of means the seam. As the story goes, the look kind of looks the seam between the two because Bantam put theirs out first. Willie's looked at it and said, okay, well, we can improve upon that. We see what they're doing. And then Willie's got the contract and went to work. Well, now we also hear about Ford is involved, right? So Ford got involved because Willie's couldn't keep up with the contract. So Ford got contracted through Willie's in order to build more Jeeps. There is significant difference, significant to insignificant, I guess, differences between the Willie's and the Ford. And that was because they didn't want to spend a whole bunch of time and money into retooling the entire Ford line. So interestingly, when we were at the Bantam Jeep Festival, you have the Bantam 1940, you have the Willys in the 41 zone, and then you have Ford that kind of speckles in there in the mix. And I think it's kind of fun because all the guys are like, nope, I have a Ford, and nope, I have a Bantam, and nobody kind of wants to sit next to each other and say that they have a Jeep. The one thing I am still digging into is understanding where the word Jeep came from. There's a couple different theories out there, and I'm not going to let you in on either one of them until I get a little bit further down into the actual story. So that was something I learned while I was there. The Omnix ADA Jeep collection is huge, and they had a portion of it at the Bantam Jeep Festival. So if you guys have ever have a chance and you're Jeep lovers, make sure that you take time to find it. It does travel every once in a while, or it's in the southeast. So make sure that you go out of your way and see that whole collection. It's really, really awesome. Part of the event was the Guinness Book of World Records attempt for the longest Jeep parade. So there's a little bit of hustle bustle about this as well. The Bantam Jeep Festival had held this Guinness book for a long, long time, this record. And a couple months back, the Jeep Beach group got together and says, well, we can beat it. And as some of you guys know, I was in the lead Jeep of that Guinness Book World Record attempt, and we beat it at Jeep Beach, going around the Daytona International Speedway. Holy cow, I still get goosebumps when I think about it. It was such an awesome opportunity. But they said, hey, we need this back at Bantam. And so they put together the rah-rahs, they got out all the flags, and unofficially, the record is now back at Bantam Jeep Festival with 2,420 Jeeps in a parade format, which, as I understand from when I was at the Jeep Beach scenario, it's a parade consists of 2.5 miles where you have to maintain consistent speed for that entire time. So pretty impressive to have 2,420 Jeeps in one place, much less in a parade. And I know of quite a few others that were that didn't participate in the parade because they had things going on with their booths and coming into town and such. So there was a lot of Jeeps there. The really cool thing that you've been watching is the first 75 Jeeps of the parade were in logical order. So it was 1940, 41, 42, 43, 44. So that's a whole progression of the years of Jeep and what's happened since then. So Scramblers in there and Flatties in there and JKs at the end. It's been a fun ride for Jeep, I would definitely say. Quick thank you to Icon Vehicle Dynamics. I jumped into their JK at the last minute. I'm like, I need a ride. We need to get there. We need to get there now so that we could get part of the parade and I could get that footage for you guys. And they let me jump in their back seat and ended up hanging out with them all night. And the BFG group, we did a really fun pizza party and then a ready set selfie for the ultimate Jeeper. So you had to go to Poison Spider, BFG, Four Wheel Parts, Method Wheels, Bear Track, Synergy, Rigid Lights, and Axial and do selfies and post them with the right hashtags. And you were the ultimate Jeeper, which had a lot of opportunities around it. Aaron Haddenbaugh was the winner of that. Also working out of the BFG tent trailer. We had a SEMA giveaway where a lucky person gets to fly into Utah, jump into a Raptor, drive to SEMA in Las Vegas, get there just in time for the score qualifying on Tuesday night, and then be at SEMA all day Wednesday as compliments of BF Goodrich tires, and get a flight back on Thursday. The winner to that was Roger Owen out of New York. So there's a lot more to the story. There's a lot more to that event. Those were just some of the key highlights, some of the things that really caught my attention. There's a whole bunch of military action that was going on there. Some really cool old setups where the guys would come out, historians came out, and they set up all their tents. They had some military pieces where the kids were running underneath all the climbing underneath the ropes and going around on top of logs, and they would get a little sticker on their side, their wings. It was really, really neat. The ride home was not as awesome, and this is some of those things where you definitely have to join our Facebook page, because it's never a lack of entertainment around here. The weather was insanely crazy in Pennsylvania. We would have, all of a sudden, this tornado warning would go through, and then it would rain, and the wind would happen, and then the sun would come out, and it was 80. Well, on Sunday, when we were headed home, we didn't have much different of luck on the tarmac, as I'm sitting in a plane with a thunder and lightning right on top of us. Like, you know how you count the seconds between the thunder and lightning? Yeah, let's go with zero. So ended up getting stranded in North Carolina for the night. No bag, no nothing. With my very first ever experience at this, with all the traveling that I do, I will offer you a couple of tips. If you ever get stranded in a location, before you leave security, like you go up to the desk, you re-get your new flight for the next day, you get your little ticket for your hotel, between that moment and the security gate, do not pout about life. Think about what you need. Go into their little store, buy your deodorant, buy your toothpaste, buy your fancy t-shirt that you want to put on for the next day, and then walk out of security, because there's nothing once you do that. So I ended up at some little runky-dunk hotel that had nothing around it other than a Cracker Barrel in the parking lot. And so that was super fun, because I'm like, oh, cool, I get great breakfast in the morning and I'll get a cute little shirt. You know, I'm thinking something with cats on it. Hey, you never know, right? And so I went into Cracker Barrel the next morning and realized they do not have my style of clothes. All right, went to the gas station next door, grabbed some toothpaste, some toothbrush, and deodorant, and hopped in the van in order to go back to the airport. No makeup, no nothing, shampoo from the hotel. Luckily, I was able to comb my hair out. So I get to the airport. I'm going through the airport saying, okay, I need a little bit of makeup, at least to feel somewhat comfortable. And I need a new t-shirt because it was pretty gross from the one before. And ooh, I just saw Brighton, I need to go shopping. So I get a t-shirt that says North Carolina on it, because I've never shopped for t-shirts before. They only have four in the entire airport. They just happen to be in different places. So I got this really pretty coral one. If you guys read the story on Facebook, it's actually hysterical. Put some smelly stuff on, find a little bit of makeup, and head to the plane. The plane ride was great. I sat next to a really awesome lady. It's kind of one of the fun parts of my job as well, is meeting new people on the plane. And so we got to the other end, I get out, and I'm still worried because where's my bag, right? And the reality is, we all know this, your bag goes with the first plane the next day. I had gone on a later flight because it was a secured seat. So I go to the lady at the baggage claim. I say, hey, I need to find my bag. Clearly I didn't get my bags from last night because of this awesome shirt that I have on. And she looks at it and she's like, oh, North Carolina, I was born and raised there. I'm like, oh, that's awesome. How about this? How about you help me find my bag and I'll give you my shirt? And she just kind of looked at me silly. So she helped me find my bag because it was her job anyways. And I went down and I got it and went straight into the bathroom, and I put on one of my I'm Not Just a Girl shirts and combed my hair and put a little bit more deodorant on and said, all right, folded up the shirt real nice and took it right back to her and said, here you go, ma'am. This is for you. You'll be beautiful in it. And made somebody's day out of that when my day was quite challenging on the rest. So we lost a whole day here at Bauer Media in the airport, but we made it. So that's the real story. There's a lot of those stories flying around, and I'm going to take this little moment of opportunity to tell you about them sometimes so you can laugh at it, because sometimes it's not always the most awesome moments. And with that, you know what? I think it's time to head back to the phone lines. What do you guys think? So we are going to start talking to an exceptional girl and a racer. And this section is brought to you by I'm Not Just a Girl. Hi, I'm Charlene, and after going to lots of events, I found something missing. Cute girl shirts that actually fit. I said, well, we can fix that. And now I design a new shirt every other month for the tough girl that wants to tell the world I'm not just a girl. We have designs with tire tread, guns, bling, American flags, camo, camping gear, and so much more. Available in extra small through 4XL, you can choose between high quality tanks, tees, or sweatshirts, and we have a whole line of jewelry and gifts as well. Visit imnotjustagirl.com to see all the designs and size charts. Available direct through Etsy, Open Sky, or at multiple events across the country. Be sure to send us photos of you being I'm Not Just a Girl to our Facebook page. And let's welcome Corry Weller to the phone lines. 2011 SR1 champion, 2012 Pro 4 Rookie of the Year, 2013 SR1 champion, 2014 SR1 champion, and 4 podiums in Pro 4 class and Lucas Oil Off-Road Racing. Girl, you got it going on.
How are you?
Good. How are you today?
I'm good. I'm really good. It's been busy, but busy's good.
Right. So you were just saying you were getting ready to go out in the racing. What does it take for you guys to prep in order to go out?
Well, it depends on if we're racing the Pro 4 or if we're racing the SR1. Pro 4 was a lot more work as far as like what we had to prep on the truck itself, and then everything we had to take and all the parts we had to order and everything we had to stick. So it was like weeks of prep for the Pro 4. The SR1, which is what I'm racing this whole year, we're taking a break off the Pro 4, is a lot easier to prep for. So mostly it's just making sure, like today, I went through our race trailer and I just made sure we had all the parts that we would need. You know, I'm shooting for 3 championships this year, so I'm trying to make sure I have all the spare parts I might need if something breaks and I'm not stuck, you know, not being able to finish the race or anything. So stocking the trailer with a lot of spare parts and just making sure that the SR1's good to go. And maintenance on that is really, really easy compared to the Pro 4. So actually working on the car doesn't really require much. I'm just changing out my tires and, you know, changing the oil and checking everything over and make sure it looks good.
So a lot of people may not understand what an SR1 is. You want to kind of just give the general outline of it?
Yeah, sure. So basically the SR1 class started in 2010. It was a class that my husband Jason and I actually kind of came up with the whole idea for the class. Basically it is an R1 street bike engine, which is 1,000cc inline four-cylinder, screams at like 14,000 RPM, I think is its top RPM, so it's a real spazzy motor, really powerful. And we put that into a Rhino chassis. So, you know, the Rhinos were racing in Core way back in like 2008, 2009. And then Lures, when Lures started, but they kind of started falling off because the Razors came out and the Terex, you know, was a V-twin. And in the UTV class back then, they were all racing together. So the Rhinos were a single cylinder trying to compete with all these, you know, double-cylinder vehicles and stuff. So they kind of started stopped racing, and they had them, people had them in their garages just sitting around. And we came up with this motor swap kit specifically for Rhinos, race Rhinos. And it was a real easy, you know, pull out your stock motor and drivetrain and drop this kit in and go out and race and be really fast. So that's kind of, in a nutshell, and trying to keep it really short, that's what an SR1 is.
Cool. So it's a Rhino with a very fast engine in it and some modifications that they're allowing in the class.
Correct, yeah. And it's very much a spec class, so it's really a driver's class. We wanted to try to take out money and horsepower and, you know, who's, you know, the companies that tend to be good fabricators and are already in business tend to do pretty well when it comes to those types of classes. And we wanted to kind of take all that out of the equation and just make it a class that was pretty affordable and very close in machines, so everybody has specific rules that they have to follow to have an SR1. You know, to be called an SR1, it has to fit within the specs of the class, and those specs are pretty strict. So, it's very much a spec class, which is nice. Why it's really fun.
Nice. Yeah, exactly. So what are your three most memorable racing moments? When did you start racing, and what are those moments that stick out in your mind?
Well, I started racing in 2001. And I hadn't raced anything before that. I didn't grow up in a racing family or anything, so that was just kind of on a whim, and I started racing motocross. So I would say probably one of the most memorable ones would be probably my first motocross race, because I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't really know how to ride. But, you know, it was so exciting and so exhilarating, and I met some of the best people that day, and so that day obviously sticks out in my mind as a very pivotal moment in my life.
Mm-hmm.
Then, you know, usually it's either wrecks or podiums that you tend to remember the most. So I remember getting my first championship in the SR1 class in 2011. It was a really big deal because I was the first female racer to win a championship in Lourdes. And so that was a big deal for me. I was really, really proud of that. We worked really hard that year. And my first podium in Pro 4 was a really cool day. Like, that was an amazing feeling to podium in that class with the drivers that I was racing with and, you know, at the level that class races. It was really, really exciting for me. It was a great day. You know, my parents were there and my family and our crew was so excited, and it felt really good. So I definitely remember, you know, things like that
and
keep you going.
Yeah, exactly. So what's one moment that maybe you keep replaying in your head is not sure, not just, I could have done this or could have done that?
So I try not to go there.
Nice. Yeah. Right.
I don't have a lot of those just because I tend to just get over stuff quick if I make a mistake or if I blow a race or I do something stupid. And, I forget it immediately, and I usually do it as I'm racing, because if you let that stuff stay with you, even throughout the rest of that race, it definitely affects the way you drive. It affects the way you think. You know, you start driving angrier or you get really frustrated, and it could just ruin your whole race. You know, I always just try to refocus and salvage whatever I can, especially in off-road racing. Sometimes you can make a mistake and still wind up on the podium or win the race. So I just try to just let it go as fast as possible, and I really just don't even dwell on it, honestly. So, yeah, I don't really have any of those, like, oh, I should have done this, I should have done that moments, just because I try to brush them off as fast as possible.
Cool. So you work in the shop with Jason at Weller Racing, and tell us a little bit about what you do in the shop and how much technology and innovation do you guys bring into your race team?
Well, what I do right now, what I'm doing basically is, I answer the phone. And, you know, I just basically help wherever they need help. Like right now, for the last few weeks, I've been doing a lot of back-end website work, you know, listing items for sale on the website and that kind of thing, and I can do that remotely from home, or I can do it from the shop. I just kind of relieve Jason up front in the office, you know, when he's busy and he's got to go in the back and work on stuff, and anything I can do to just, you know, make his day go a little easier and make sure that he can work where he's going to be most useful that day is mostly what I do, unless we're prepping for a race like this week, you know, and then I do the race trailer stuff and my car and things like that. Innovation-wise, you know, we specialize, we've kind of always made our niche in, rhinos, which is kind of funny. You know, I think we've probably done more rhino motors than most companies out there. So we sort of specialize. Jason's really good at seeing where weaknesses are in OEM products and coming up with a fix for those, you know, by developing our own products that are beefier or designed, I don't want to say better than OEM, but more in relation to what the consumer is actually doing with that product.
Yeah.
Sometimes what the consumer does with it and what the OEM intended it for are two different things.
Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah. So we specialize in that, and that's something that you know, we have a knack for. And then motors, you know, Jason's just a very, very good motor builder. He understands any kind of motor inside and out. He's just got a gift for that. So, you know, anything like that. Electrically, he's really good. We just started doing race packs for UTVs and working with race pack as far as data logging and getting information from the motor and things like that, so to help people get more out of their motor and run it better and make sure that the tuning's all right and, you know, that kind of stuff. So,
sure.
Yeah, that's what we do in a nutshell.
So how do you feel working in the shop every day and being hands-on with your race prep helps you out while you're racing?
I think it's really huge, actually, because the more I get hands-on, the more I get involved in actually fixing my car, working on the car, or the truck. The Pro 4, I was the same way. I wanted to be able to take apart the whole truck and put it all back together. You know, I wanted to have that experience. Because there's times when you're out on the track, if something goes wrong or something's failing or, you know, something's broken, and you know how everything works and all the parts that put everything together, you can help diagnose what's going on and know whether you should keep running it or know if you should just pull off right now and save something, you know. And also for testing and setting up your vehicle, too, you know, the better feedback I can give Jason, he's my crew chief, so, you know, a lot of times, I'm trying to tell him what my car feels like or what my truck feels like so he can adjust the suspension or tune it better. So the more I understand the inner workings of whatever it is I'm driving, it just makes me a much more effective communicator as far as being a driver and communicating with whoever is setting up my vehicle. So I think it's a really big, plus, you know, he's always busy at the track helping other people. So a lot of times it's just me and I have to fix my own stuff. So that comes in handy if you know what you're doing.
Right, exactly. So what's one piece of advice that you'd give to the next generation of racers, or, you know, to another girl that's trying to strive and be the Corry Weller, looks at your pictures and is your fan on Facebook and wants to be like you?
You know, probably a couple things, especially since you throw the girl part of it in there. General racers, I would say, you know, just, and I kind of see a lack of this sometimes with the younger racers coming in, just, you know, respect your fellow driver, respect the people that you're on the track with. I think it's really important to respect the fact that they've spent a lot of time and money to get there and put that time and effort and money into their vehicle. And, you know, when everybody's out on the track racing each other, I really like clean racing. And I think a lot of that comes from just respecting the people that you're on the track with, you know. That's probably huge for me. And then, on the girl side of it, I don't know. You know, I would say, again, you know, respect your drivers. I've always kind of not really flaunted the fact that I'm a girl and I'm out there racing. Because usually, you know, you're racing with a bunch of guys in this sport particularly. So I just always wanted to be considered and looked at as just another racer that they have to be, or that they're trying to keep from beating them.
Right.
And so I always just kind of operate that same way. You know, I don't throw it out there. I don't tell guys, hey, I beat you, and rub it in their face or anything. It's always very much, you know, be a good sportsman. Say that they had a great race. Shake your hand. You know, just treat them as an equal, and they'll treat you the same way, and there won't be any of that. You know, people wonder if you get treated different as a girl when you're on the track, and I really don't, and I think that might be, you know, just kind of a part of why that hasn't happened yet.
I agree with all that. I definitely agree with that. Stick your hand out and shake their hand and be part of it, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, when you respect other people, they're going to respect you. And it's just kind of a mutual thing, which makes racing really fun.
Yes. Yeah, so you have a ton of fans. You have a great Facebook page going on. You have a lot of interaction. I have to ask, what has been the craziest fan interaction that you've had?
Oh, gosh. So... I mean, there's a couple that just kind of stand out. I used to have this group of guys, and I honestly, like, I don't even, I would assume they're probably still following me on Facebook, and they probably come to some races, and I used to call them my super fans. And they would always come, and they would drink, and they would have fun, and they would come, you know, woo, Corry, yelling and screaming, and hang out, and just cause this big old scene whenever they saw me out, you know, in the pits, which I'm kind of quiet, and I tend to just kind of want to do my thing, you know, and go here and go there without anybody seeing me. And they'd always call me out whenever I was out, out in the pit area. So they were really funny. And then I have a fan, I think he lives in Wyoming. I know he follows me. And he actually painted, he has a Chevy Blazer, and he painted his truck to look like my race truck. And I thought that was really cool. Plus, aww, I have a lot of fans who do, you know, the RC trucks.
Yeah.
And so I'm always getting fan pictures, and they're always like, hey, look, I did my truck like your Pro 4.
Nice.
You know, showing me pictures and stuff. So I think that's great, too. I have the best fans. I have the best group of fans, I have to say. They're always really upbeat and really positive, and it's always really fun to be able to talk to them on Facebook and Instagram and stuff.
Yeah, it is. It's a ton of fun to follow you. I'm not going to lie. I'm one of your fans. I like you.
Okay,
here's the big questions of the day. Are you ready? This is where it gets deep.
Okay.
Biggest pet peeve while driving on the street every day. Go.
Oh, geez. Okay. So usually I'm pretty mellow. Takes a lot to get me, you know, riled up and angry. But, and this happens in California more than Arizona. Sorry, California, but it's true. People who cannot merge onto the freeway.
Oh.
Meaning they're coming on an on-ramp, and, you know, you're supposed to match speed and merge into traffic that's on the freeway. And this always happens when I'm pulling either the race trailer or I'm towing, like, my Pro 4. They just refuse to merge. So they'll either come up, as they're coming up, they maintain their speed, they're right next to me, and all of a sudden, you know, their road runs out. And I'm still going my speed, and they haven't merged yet, and they freak out and go off the side or, you know, honk their horn to be heard. And it's like, hey, I think I have the right of way, and you should definitely be paying attention when you're merging. So that, and it happens all the time. I don't know how they cannot see this gigantic
huge thing coming.
Big face on it, you know. So that gets me more upset probably than anything. Otherwise, I'm pretty mellow.
All right, and last one. Duct tape or zip ties?
Duct tape, just because they make it in some really awesome colors and patterns.
I love it. Well, Corry, thank you so much for being on the show. You're definitely an inspiration to many, and especially to a lot of girls out there that are striving to jump into the race team, race group. So thank you very much. For anybody that wants to catch up with Corry, go to corryweller.com or like her on Facebook. Our next guest is going to tell us all about an exciting event that you're going to want to put on your bucket list. And that event is also brought to you by BF Goodrich Tires.
Are you driver enough to handle the ultra-high performance of the new BF Goodrich G-Force Comp 2 all-season tire or the rugged toughness of the all-terrain TAK02? From August 31st to September 27th, get a $50 or $70 MasterCard reward card after submission when you buy a set of four new BF Goodrich passenger or light truck tires. Head to your local BF Goodrich dealer today. See redemption form for complete offer details. Offer expires 9/27/2015. Void where prohibited. Reward card issued by U.S. Bank pursuant to license from MasterCard International Incorporated.
And we have Jeff Knoll on the phone from RallyVenture. RallyVenture is crisscrossing the country, I hope, soon. But started in Reno. I've done the one in Moab, and I'm getting ready to go to Reno to join you. Jeff, I'm so excited for you to really help us understand what RallyVenture is and how you're developing this.
Well, it's actually the next generation in pretty much a lifetime of off-roading. For me, as you know, Charlene, I've done a ton of different events over the years. I've got about 15 years now of putting on four-wheel drive events from a professional standpoint, and another 10 or so years before that with clubs and various charities. So no stranger to putting on off-road events.
Yep.
And this kind of is the culmination of all these years of experience wrapped into one, and then you interject the social media aspect of it. So a lot of stuff going on with RallyVenture. There's a lot of moving parts. And, you know, for some folks, it's a little hard for them to understand everything that's going on. So I'm hoping I can kind of share that with them today.
Yeah, I think it's awesome because there is a lot of moving parts. And the piece, of course, I love the most is the social media aspect. But let's start at ground zero. So I show up on Wednesday. Help me out. Give me some insight to you. Like, how am I going to win?
Well, you know, the thing is, Charlene, that's kind of a loaded question. Tony Pellegrino from GenRite had the same question last year. He's like, you know, how do I win at RallyVenture? And my response to him was, you win by bringing your family and having a good time. And he at first had a little bit of a hard time with that, and then after he got about halfway through the event, he could really see that RallyVenture is, while it's a competition and we're all competitive, it's more about having a great time and doing things with your family and seeing off-roading maybe in a little different light. You know, there's about 7 billion people in the world, and 4.5 billion of them are on mobile phones now. So you've got this interaction that pretty much connects us to the world all the time. And, I'm sure you see it. We all see that everybody's out there sharing all these things. What I wanted to do is really drive home the family aspect of off-roading and do something that's fun for everybody. And in Tony's case, he had a really good time because he's got two teenage sons. The oldest is in his 20s, but everybody was engaged, and his wife had a job, the two kids had a job, and he had a job, and they all got to play together. And, you know, that's what I really wanted to bring home, is showing the world the adventure that I like when I go to Baja or something, and I love being out in the middle of nowhere. I don't normally get to take my family with me because we're strapping on helmets and head and neck restraints, and we're driving as fast as we can across the desert. RallyVenture brings home that adventure to the family and allows you to do it in mostly a stock Jeep.
Okay, so you say everybody has a job. What does that mean? I know there's going to be four seats in the Jeep, so explain. Clearly, the one person is in charge of driving, using the turn signals, and being safe. What's the right seat job?
So when I started off-roading as a young adult, in my Jeep, my favorite pastime with my friends was to pull out a bunch of maps and then pick a line on the map and chase that line, basically find out where it goes. So what we've done with RallyVenture is we've mixed in that navigation challenge. So the foundation of the event is truly, it's a navigational challenge. So the passenger's job would typically be they're doing the map reading. And It's not as simple as we give you a GPS download. We give you tulip charts like they use in the Dakar Rally. We give you tulip charts like they use in road rallies. So you've got two different forms of tulip chart navigation. You've got some odometer stuff that you've got to do, so it's time, distance, speed rally stuff. And then we mix in some map reading. And in some cases, we might even just draw you out directions like your grandmother would give you, saying, you know, turn right at the old fence and go down the road until you see the old water tower, and when you get to the old pickup truck, you went too far. And then, of course, there's GPS and geocache mixed in with that as well. So you've got to be able to work all these different types of navigation if you're sitting in the passenger seat.
Okay, so I think that's my job. So I can do it all from my phone. I have to have a big GPS.
It's really up to you. We had Brian Crofts last year. He and his brother ran, and they did the entire event with only a smartphone. In contrast, we have guys that have multiple iPads going, laptop computers, GPS units, you know, the big Lowrance GPS unit like you'd use in racing, just tons and tons of variation on what you would use. And literally, Brian and his brother did the entire event and finished very respectfully and only used their iPhone the entire day.
Nice.
They used it for compass reading. They used it for GPS locations. They basically used it for everything. So, you know, we're a connected world now, and they've got an app for just about anything.
Got an app for that.
Yeah.
All right. So that's the right seat. Tell me about one of the back seats.
So one of the back seats. Now, you don't need a team of four. You can literally do this with two people. It's very difficult with one. I have tried it. With two, it gets to be a little cumbersome, but you can do it. Nick Sosh and I did the Moab Rally Venture event test with just the two of us, and we had a great time doing it. But it's a little bit more fun when you take more people. So one of the typical jobs for a person in the back seat would be collecting all the media. So one of the interesting things is that it's not just about finding the locations, but when you get to the location, we give you different tasks that you have to do. So as an example, last year, Billet Rifle Systems, who's a sponsor of RallyVenture, had set up target shooting with custom-made AR-15s. And so one of the people on the team had to shoot the targets while another person was taking a photo and uploading that to social media. So
nice.
The backseat guys really get to choose on whether they're going to be the person that runs the tasks. And an example of another task would be like slacklining between, you know, a crevice or something, or kayaking, finding different geocache locations that might require you to do a little hiking, or finding wildflowers. We've done a lot of the wildflower collection, which seems to be pretty popular. So the two backseat people are kind of, they mix it up between actually running around and doing the tasks and loading all the social media and capturing the photos.
All right, and so how many different social media outlets should we be posting to, or how does that work? What's the thought? What's the theory?
Well, we've got three that we primarily use, and we're going to add a fourth this year during the Reno event. We're going to do some experimentation with, and there's really more layers of social media that the individual teams get the most out of. But primarily, we use Instagram for our scoring. We also use Facebook for scoring and Twitter for scoring. So what you'd have to do is have your Instagram account set up and linked in with your Twitter and your Facebook feed. Most people do that nowadays where they're all linked together and they use one primary outlet and then it just kind of propagates the others. But for the sake of RallyVenture, we primarily score everything from Instagram. Now this year we're going to try out a new form of social media. It's an app called Periscope. And this was a startup company that was recently purchased by Twitter. It's a pretty cool little deal, and it allows you to live stream video right from your mobile device.
Yeah, Corry Weller was just on with us, and she's been doing that quite a bit. I've been online with her live. So that'll be fun. So we can actually stream live. We'll actually stream live via Twitter on while we're out and about. How much of the trail is going to be... I don't know, cell phone accessible? Like, are we going to be able to do it the whole time, or we have to come back to town like we have to in so many other scenarios?
Well, you know, it is northern Nevada, and it is pretty remote, but I believe we have about 65% to 70% coverage. So while you will have black spots, you do have areas that we've identified that, you know, when you go into a dead zone, you may be in a dead zone for about 45 minutes, and there are challenges that we require you to do in some of those zones. And then we tell you in the rally book that you get, hey, you have service now. You know, make sure you start posting before you get to your next checkpoint. So the checkpoints are primarily virtual, meaning that when you show up, you do the task, you take the picture, you load it to social media. I've got a team of like six people back at headquarters that are monitoring all this stuff and doing the scoring, and then we're also uploading that to social media. So you really, if you're not a participant in the RallyVenture, you can be a participant virtually by supporting your team that you're after or just following along on the social media site for RallyVenture. So, I mean, there's stuff to do all day long, even if you're not in the event. You get to participate because we'll have challenges where we'll ask a team, whoever gets the most likes or the most shares gets an extra point, things like that. So at the end of the day, it's not a race. It's literally you're trying to earn as many points as possible using social media.
So you have turned this into a two-day on-the-ground, wheels in the dirt event. And how many miles, and how do you split the days? And like you just said, it's not a race, but how does that all fall down?
Well, I can't give away too many of the details, but I can tell you that our day one is about 90 miles, and it's about 6 hours of driving. Our day two is less mileage, but it's still about the same amount of hours out collecting the tasks. So this year, we've toned down the driving, and we've upped all the skills and challenges that we're requiring people to do. So last year was a 200-mile course, and the stages and the checkpoints were very quick. Like in some cases, you had 2 minutes to literally run to the spot, get the picture, and run back. And some of the feedback we got from our competitors were, hey, you know, we really like going to these historic locations. We want to spend more time kind of exploring the locations and less time driving. So we've cut back the mileage and spread it over 2 days.
Okay, that's cool. So people can expect to see pictures of us in historical locations and lunch stops, next to rocks. I'm just kind of going back to my Moab adventure. We were trying to find certain flowers, and we were trying to set ourselves, you know, to mimic your picture that you had in our guidebook. Like, those are the opportunities, right? The events that we have to do.
Yeah, and then this year we're going to add in not only the live streaming stuff from Periscope, but, you know, one of the cool things about Instagram is you can load video on there now, so as well as Facebook. So we're going to have some more video interaction, which is going to be kind of fun. We found this really cool location, and I don't want to let the cat out of the bag, but we found this really cool location that's super hard to find, and the guys that find it, or the teams that find it, are going to be required to spoof an old movie and make a short video that's kind of spoofing this old movie at this location. So I anticipate it's going to be really fun for the people back home as well as the people that are participating.
All right, awesome. What kind of vehicles? They have to be street legal.
Yeah, street legal vehicles. I've run all of the trails in a bone stock 2015 Rubicon JK two-door. So, I mean, nothing special. You need to have really solid tires because Northern Nevada is rocky, and I think the worst thing that'll happen to you is you might get a flat tire if you're not running the right brand tire. But you can do it in a stock vehicle. You don't need lockers necessarily, but it does help. And we expect the teams to be 100% self-sufficient. So, you know, whatever you feel like you need to go out into the backcountry, we expect you to have it. And a big part of that is what we like to call a go bag. And basically that go bag is all the items you would need in a backpack or a small sack to sustain your life if you had to stay on the side of the trail for 4 to 6 hours or even potentially overnight. Now, we do run a sweep, and we have a pretty good idea of where everybody's at all times, but you just never know.
Right.
So along the same lines of trying to promote responsible recreation, we're also trying to promote the idea of being prepared to go into the backcountry.
Cool. Well, I'm looking forward to going into the backcountry, but while we're in town, you also have some evening events and parties, and give us a quick rundown on those.
Well, the coolest thing is it's almost like a mixture of an off-road event and Cannonball Run and, you know, some of the Gumball Rally stuff, because every night there's a party.
Yep.
We're at the Nugget Casino in Reno, Nevada, so you know that's going to be fun.
Yep.
We've got PRP Seats is hosting our welcome party and happy hour. So basically when you show up to register, we're going to buy you a beer. PRP is going to buy you a beer. And you're going to get a cool collectible glass pint glass that's got the RallyVenture logo on it, PRP logo on it, and they're going to fill it up for beer. And, you know, we have this mixer. And then after that, we're going to sit you down and feed you a great meal. We have prime rib on tap this year. For a sit-down dinner with Linens, that's hosted by Poison Spider Customs and Four Wheel Parts. And then we're going to dive right into figuring out what our starting order is and having our driver's meeting. So you get to enjoy a cocktail and a meal while you do the driver's meeting instead of, you know, maybe just sitting in a folding chair and listening to me talk. So
sure.
Good first night. And then we've actually got a really cool challenge planned on the first night where we're going to basically start the event on Wednesday night. We're going to make you guys get out there and earn some points.
Okay.
On Thursday night, we're bringing back the Raceline Rodeo at Gilly's Saloon inside the Nugget. Last year we had a great time with this. Greg Mulkey's our host for this. As always, he shows us a good time. And we're going to do a virtual rodeo with a $200 prize for the winner. And then my personal favorite is Greg's Buckle Bunny Pageant. And we're paying $300 to the winner of the Buckle Bunny Pageant this year. It is a hoot. He makes the girls do all kinds of fun stuff. So a lot of fun there. And then we're going to wrap it up with the Genrite Rap Party on Saturday night at the local cantina that's right down the street from the Nugget Casino on Victoria Avenue. And that is going to be our wrap party. We're going to do a Mexican dinner there for our participants and then give out our awards on Friday night. So
awesome.
Lots going on.
Awesome. So Wednesday through Friday, and Reno, Nevada, July. I will be there with my bells on. I will be in the BF Goodrich Brute. Corry is going to be driving. I got the right seat. So if we get lost, folks, I'll just take responsibility for it right now.
Well, I wouldn't be too afraid of getting lost. We had 22 competitors last year. Only about half of them finished the entire day, but we only had two minor breakdowns. They were both easily fixed. Everybody made it back alive. And you know, the crazy thing is, with only 22 teams, we monitored the posts, and we ended up with almost 5 million impressions out of the day. For a first-time event, we were pretty happy with that. So it's going to be a lot of fun, and I anticipate we're really going to just have a huge following online. So I don't think you're going to get too lost. We'll make sure and get you back, Charlene.
Thanks, Jeff. All right, well, thanks, Jeff, for spending your time with us today and helping explain this event. I know that there's so many layers to it. I think this really helped answer a lot of my questions, which I think will also help answer a lot of others. There's still a couple spots left, but you better get in touch with Jeff, like, right now, if not yesterday. And I will see you in July.
Yeah, check us out on social media. RallyVenture.com is the website. And obviously at RallyVenture and the hashtag RallyVenture and all that stuff. I just want to give a shout out real fast if I could, Charlene. I've had some really great sponsors over the years. Some of them have been with me as long as 15 years, and I couldn't do it without these guys. Guys like PRP Seats and Raceline. BF Goodrich has always been there for me since the beginning. Of course, Genrite's been a good partner. And this year I've got some new partners that I haven't worked with before, but we're really excited about it. Cabela's is supporting this, Spiderweb Shade,
great.
Poison Spider Customs, and of course, like I mentioned before, Billet Rifle Systems is back. So got some good team members to help us propel Rally Venture, hopefully into expansion in 2015 and 16.
Cool. Well, we are going to move on to a new and developing segment brought to you by Kicker Audio.
If you drive a utility vehicle, Jeep, or motorcycle, Kicker Audio has the power sports stereo gear to entertain you at any location. The gear is compact, weatherproof, and provides you with great sounding music wherever the job or fun takes you. See your authorized Kicker dealer for your off-road tunes.
So our new and developing segment is called Oh Wow. Now, this might be something where I fall off the deep end, I might get into a little bit of trouble, but you know what? I'm just going to kind of set it out there. This is going to be the controversial section. Couple minutes, 3 minutes, you have the floor. Talk about something that's going on. Talk about something that's frustrating. And then that's your opinion. That's the oh wow, right? Oh wow, okay, that's your opinion. Got it. And then we take it online and let's discuss it. And you know what? Maybe we come up with a solution to this challenge that's happening in either the off-road world or the world in general. It can be the world in general. You know, that could be just as fun. So if you have a topic that you want to talk about, make sure you go to BauerPowerHour.com. If you go to the contacts page, there's a little drop down box there. Say, oh, wow. And then put in your question, put in your information, put in your topic, and we'll get in touch with you. And you could be a guest on this show. But with that being said, guys, it is time to wrap up the very first episode of Bauer Power Hour. Again, I'm really excited, and I'm even more excited to go forward into next week. We have another A-plus lineup ready for you. Powerball questions. You have the opportunity also to ask all of the guests a question. Again, you go to our website, and you can see right there how to do it. If we choose your question as one of the Powerball questions, we will send you a very fancy Bauer Power Hour t-shirt that I just designed and a couple gifts along with it that I know that you'll like. So make sure that you do that. And there's also a place right there to put your t-shirt size in. So don't skip it at the bottom. Otherwise, I'll be sending you a small. That's what it's defaulted to. Little awkward. Please make sure that you follow us on our website, Bauer Power Hour, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, Bauer Power Hour Show. And we really look forward to seeing you a lot this year on the show. You can also listen to us on all of our podcast outlets as well. So pick a place, understand what's best for you, and make sure you come back every week on Monday when a new episode of Bauer Power Hour is released. See you soon.
Want to learn more about the guests on today's show? Visit www.bowerpowerhour.com for more information, photos, and videos. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter by searching for Bower Power Hour Show for daily breaking news updates.